morning. Happy Sunday, everybody. This is another song just saying how much we love the Lord, and I think that's at the heart of all worship. So this is a beautiful one.
One, I adore, beautiful one, my soul. Good morning. Welcome. I greet you in the name of our risen Lord Jesus Christ on this wonderful day. I pray that we are all blessed by being with fellow believers, brothers and sisters in Christ. And we have just sung praises to God, and our God inhabits praise. So we know God is here with us. So we will truly be blessed this morning. Let's continue to praise God with being led by this very familiar looking guy, my son Jesse. Join with me in the opening prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for being a God who speaks, who delights to reveal yourself to your children through your word. By Jesus, you created the world. Through Jesus, you sustain all things. What a merciful, kind, and generous God you are. Open the eyes of our hearts to see and embrace such a hope. To see Jesus is to see everything we need to understand and grasp about you, Father. To know Jesus is to rest in the good news that indeed he is working all things for our good and for your glory. But Father, the greatest joy comes from knowing that Jesus' sacrifice for our sins is complete. He paid the price for our sins by dying on the cross. You cannot love us more, and you will never love us less. We praise, bless, and adore you for so measureless a salvation and so magnificent a Savior. In Jesus' tender and triumphant name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. Ambassadors for Christ is what you are. I'd like for you to join with me. You put up the vision statement. We are a Christ-centered family of Christians. We are actively seeking to grow the kingdom of God by bringing the word and the love of God to the community. We may not always think alike, but we always love alike as God has taught us. Wonderful couple of sentences that our church council put together. Maybe it was a year ago, was it? But just great wordsmiths in the power that they succinctly put our mission statement together with. And I'm appreciative of that effort. I want to talk to you about Acts 29 and our outreach. Did you happen to give a card to someone you knew this week? Hopefully you did. Hopefully you're able to express your love for your church and for your beliefs. In front of me, I have haves and have-nots, and that, of course, includes all you folks at home sitting on the couch. And you go, haves and have-nots, what are you talking about? It's those of you who viewed The Chosen. I want to take a quick survey. How many of you have seen some or all the TV series The Chosen? Raise your hand if you would here in the sanctuary. Ah, man, you're missing out. No, Jack? Oh, my goodness. Oh. Carol Tate's the only one who's raised her hand in the sanctuary this morning. And I'm sure she's blessed, right, Carol? It's worth your time. So you go, all right, so how can I view this TV series? Well, you can go on YouTube. It's so far we've been able to see two seasons of it. I think the first season had 8 episodes. But what I want you to understand is this is a TV series that shows how Jesus is putting together his disciples. And you get to see and hear the portrayal of this and how the disciples view Jesus. It's well done. The storyline is terrific, of course. But understand that the pandemic interfered a little bit with the production. So we're in, I can view up to the end of, or the middle of season 2 right now. There is going to be a season 3, but just to understand how good this is a production that was funded through, what do they call it, crowdfunded, and it is the top most crowdfunded endeavor ever. So that in itself says a lot. It also, if you follow Rotten Tomato, The critics rated it at 100%, the audience at 98%. So obviously it's worth your time to check this out. You can get it on your iPhone or your, you know, Android. You can get it on your phone. You can get it on your computer, your iPad, whatever. It's easy to get to. So here's what it was going to be. You either watch it. So it looks like the majority of you are going to watch it this week. This is your outreach activity, all right? So it's, you're going to be blessed by it. If you've seen it, Carol, you're going to push it on to somebody else and say, hey, you need to tune into this. It's worth your time, all right? So there's your Acts 29 outreach. And I was sharing with my son this morning, as a matter of fact, this The Chosen. So here, this is for all you visual learners, The Chosen. All right, now we're going to hear from Ann Simpson.
Deep and wide, there's a fountain flowing deep and wide.
Good morning. Today I'd like to share with you one of my favorite Bible verses. It starts with, God so loved the world. God so loved the world. How big is God's world? Can we measure it? If I were baking or cooking, I might use a measuring cup and fill it to the top with flour or sugar. Can we measure God's love that way? In Psalm 23, it says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. My cup runneth over." If our cup runs over with God's love, well, then I guess we don't need that. So how else do we measure things? If we're going to build something, we might want to measure a doorway or a wall and see how high it is or how wide it is or how deep it is. Would that help us to measure God's world? We now have a Land Rover on Mars. It took a long, long time for that spaceship to get to Mars, and yet that isn't heaven. So what does the Bible say? In Psalm 108, it's in verse 4, it says, God's love is higher than the heavens. If God's love is higher than the heavens, measuring tape isn't going to do us any good. What about time? We measure things in time. You might have to measure how many minutes you have for time out when you didn't do something you were supposed to do. Or you might want to measure how many days or how many months it is until your birthday. So sometimes we measure it with a watch. Can we measure God's love by using time or a watch? I don't think so. In Psalm 103, it says God's love is everlasting to everlasting, and that cannot be measured with a watch. So how do we measure God's love? Let me finish that Bible verse for you from John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. How do you measure a love like that? We can't measure it. We don't need to. All we need to do is experience it. From Ephesians, I'd like to read for you. My prayer for you today is that you may understand how wide, how long, how high, how deep his love really is. May you experience it, though it is so great that you will never fully understand it. Just experience God's love and know the peace that God's love can bring you inside you. So every day, please thank God for his love, for giving his Son to us, for having him die on the cross for our sins, and remember that joyfully he rose again from the dead. Every day, thank God, for today is a present from God. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Audubon United Methodist Church, and thank you for worshiping with us today. You know, I did a greeting much like this about 6 months ago, October of last year. And in that greeting, I was talking about how the 6 months prior to that had not seen any changes. I was still wearing comfortable clothes to go to a church service virtually. I was still in my home office, working out of home. My daughter was attending college from the dining room table. My other daughter was attending high school virtually from here at home. And my dogs were as happy as they've ever been because we were all here all the time. Well, now another 6 months has gone by. I'm still in my home office. I'm still wearing comfortable clothes, attending a church service virtually. My daughters are still studying from home. And let me show you how nice it's gotten for the dogs. Yeah, they've moved right here into the office with me. So then I started thinking, well, maybe it's good that some things don't change. It's nice that we have the love of the Lord to get us through these times. And it's really nice to be able to worship here at Audubon United Methodist. So welcome, enjoy, and we hope to see you every week. Thanks.
Boy, I can identify with that. My dogs have never been happier, all three of them. They're right by my side at my home office in the living room. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you this morning. We praise you for all your many great acts. Some we take for granted, many hopefully we truly appreciate and are blessed by and we thank you for. Lord, we thank you for vaccines. We thank you that there is hope for this dreaded pandemic. And we thank you that this church is open, even in just this limited way, that we can come together as your children to worship you and be built up as your church. We thank you for everyone in this church who does so much. We thank you for the people who work hard to broadcast this service to those at home. We thank you for those in leadership positions, trustees, treasurers, everything, all the work that needs to be done. And we thank you, Lord, that there are workers in this field. And we thank you so much for the wonderful pastor that we have. And we pray that this time of vacation for her truly be a renewing experience and that she come back to us next week fully charged and ready to share her love for the Lord with us. Lord, there are so many needs that we have. So, my goodness, beyond measure, for we at times are so helpless. But Lord, may we always turn to you for the help that we need. For all things are possible through you, Lord. So may we always have that type of faith that can move mountains, that can cure people, that can reach out to others who need to hear the word. Lord, we pray for those in our congregation who are hurting, who've had tragedy in their lives, sickness. But we thank you, Lord, for those that you've brought through. We thank you that Barry Zane is home from the hospital now. And we thank you for your care in his life. And we would ask that you would be with Jen as she travels home, driving alone over a long distance. But Lord, keep her alert, keep her safe, and keep her in your care. Oh Lord, so many blessings you give us. And for these and all the innumerable blessings, we give you alone the praise and the glory in the matchless name of our only Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The people of God said, amen. And now let's continue with the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I will be reading today's scripture lesson. Please stand as I read God's holy word. There will be two readings today. First, from the Old Testament, a reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." And the second reading is from the New Testament, the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by a Son, who he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. May God bless the reading of his holy word. You may be seated.
What do we mean when we say created in the image of God? Historically, a lot of people felt that it was, we looked like them. Two arms, two legs. I mean, Michelangelo definitely thought that. If you've ever been to the Sistine Chapel and looked up and seen his great artwork, I'll tell you what, I'll save you a trip. Here it is, right here. You ready? There it is. Look at that. God with a big flowing beard. Boy, if that were the image, I think I'd be further ahead. But that's not the image. I once heard someone say, "Yes, I'm made in God's image, but you can still tell us apart." So if the image of God is not in physical appearance, let's look at some of the characteristics we share with God. First, we are self-aware. We each recognize that we are a unique individual. In fact, we're so self-aware that we don't even think about it. Yet we think and we plan internally, seeing the world from inside ourselves. We also recognize that there are others out there who are not us. We think in terms of you and I, recognizing our individuality. Now, what does our self-awareness have to do with being in God's image? It's because God is the most self-aware being there is. In Exodus 3:13, we read, Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the sons of Israel and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you.' And they ask me, 'What is his name? What should I say to them?' And God answers him by saying, 'Yahweh,' which means, 'I am who I am.'" You don't get much more self-aware than that. An interesting thing about that name has to do with the grammar involved. In Hebrew, verb tenses are very vague and often use past tense for future events and vice versa. So in effect, God is saying, "I was, I am, and I will always be." You see, God, for all of his omnipresence, is still an individual and not some cosmic power like the Force in Star Wars. We can talk to God, and if we're really quiet and focused, we can hear him talk to us. And this is what God wants. A key element in recognizing that we are all individuals is the desire to reach out to other individuals and create relationships. And this is what God has intended from the beginning. As he said in Genesis, "It is not good that man should be alone." God has even been reaching out to us since the beginning in order to have a personal relationship with us, to the extent that he even took human form in Jesus to fix the broken relationship we had with him. If we recognize that this desire for relationship comes because we are in the image of God, then we must recognize that everyone else is also made in that image and are worthy of our friendship and respect. And we should be doing everything in our own limited power to to fix the broken relationships that are so plentiful in our world. Second characteristic we share with God is free will. Now you may be thinking, of course God has free will, but you'd be surprised how often we don't act that way. We presume to know how God will act and how he will respond to the things we do. The story of Job is a perfect example. Basically, God is in heaven, and Satan, who is, we say Satan, but in ancient Middle East, every court, royal court, had a Satan, which we probably best translated today as devil's advocate. His job was to point out other things to the king, to disagree with the king, to make the king think more. And so Satan or Satan says to God, you know, this guy Job, yeah, he loves you, but that's only because you've blessed him. If you take away all those blessings, he'll curse you. And God agrees to this plan. And Job loses everything. I mean everything. He loses his home, his cattle, his wife, his children, everything. And he even gets diseases and boils, and he's just sitting in the dirt, despairing. Then his three friends show up. And for the next 35 chapters, they argue, his three friends saying, you've obviously sinned, and that's why you're being punished. And Job is saying, no, I haven't. God is being unfair to me. And that goes on for 35 chapters until God finally steps in and says, where were you when the morning stars sang together? Where were you when I created this world? Can you do this? Can you do this? Basically saying, you don't know what I do. God has free will. Now, Paul reminds us in Romans 9:15, for he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So I'll tell you, we should not get too complacent about our salvation, about our relationship with God. We should be working harder all the time and not saying we know. But what about our free will? At times it seems we might be better off without it, but God wants us to recognize that there are choices in life and hopes that we'll make the right ones. As Paul says in Galatians 5:13, for you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become servants to one another. God will not force us, but he truly desires for us to make the right choices, and most importantly, to love him by our own free will. A third characteristic we get from God is the ability and desire to create. God created everything. But from the earliest days, man has been building things. Houses, cities, monuments, walls, tombs, and myriad forms of architecture. Some so amazing, they've been designated wonders of the world. We also create art and music, which inspire and uplift our spirits. Of course, this is only a pale imitation of the God who created everything from nothing, but we use what God has created in order to create new and hopefully useful, worthwhile things. Arts have blessed this church. You heard Lynn sing. I mean, my goodness, I love her voice. She is such a blessing to us. David on the piano and organ. We have so much talent in music. And in architecture, look around this room. Look at the beautiful woodwork. Look at the stained glass. All created to give glory to God and to edify his people. Furthermore, when a man and a woman get together, they're able to create a new life. Is there anything that mankind can do that is more creative than that? Using what God has given them, our parents were able to create us. And with God's help, F and I were able to create two wonderful sons. The fourth characteristic is probably the most important, and that is the ability to love. 1 John 4:16 says, "So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them." Those simple but valuable three little words, God is love, tell us everything we need to know about God. And that love has been made so evident in Jesus. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." Not only is God love, but he wants us to love also. When Jesus was asked what the greatest commandment was, he replied, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Jesus also told his disciples, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should love one another." This is the charge that we have been given, to love one another. And Jesus makes it clear that we are to love everyone, not just those that we like. Love your enemies is one of the hardest things Jesus told us. But it is nothing less than what he himself did. Even as he was being crucified, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." This is a hard calling, especially in today's polarized and politicized world. But it is nonetheless what we are called to do, and the reason for this calling comes from the idea of image in its meaning back when Genesis was written. Get to the crux of the matter here, as they say. If we look at the cultures around ancient Israel, we see some interesting historical customs. Rulers in those days could not be everywhere at once, and travel was very, very slow. So they would erect monuments with their name or statues with their likeness throughout their kingdom. These images let everyone know that the king's rule extended wherever his image was found. The same was true in those days of idols. Idols represented a god and also represented the god's rule and showed that the god was in some mysterious way present. But God, with a capital G, actually forbid this practice. See Commandment 2 of 10. "You shall make no graven images." In other words, no idols representing God. And this is the important part. Instead, we are the images representing God's rule and in some ways enforcing it. After God created Adam and Eve, he gave them dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. This is the image God has created in us to be his representatives here on earth. Or as Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:20, "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us." You've heard it said that you may be the only Bible people ever see. I'd like to rephrase this, that you may be the only Christ they ever see. May we all live up to our calling and truly be the image of God. Amen? Amen. We'll close our service with "Love Divine, All Loves Excelling."
Dwelling on
Now, before I give the benediction, just a couple of brief announcements. Pastor Jisun will be back with us next Sunday. Yay. Looking forward to that. And second, in the back of the sanctuary is an offering plate. I know we don't take the offering. The CDC would like us to stay healthy, but the CDC does not want us to go broke either. So the offering plate is in the back. And now please receive the benediction. As you leave this place, may you be strengthened by the Holy Spirit to fulfill your role as the image of God. Go in confidence and go in peace. Amen.